Heart for the World, what's going on? It's Brother Joseph.
Brother Preston here.
How y'all doing? I just want to say I miss y'all. I remember growing up, Sunday service, Sunday morning, Sunday school was probably my favorite time growing up. Getting to color, read stories about the Bible, seeing my friends, and of course snack time was always the best. But most of all, now that I'm older, I miss going to church. I miss seeing all those friendly faces, them good Christian, good-hearted people, you know, and then those hugs. Those what I miss the most. But I just want to say I love you guys. It's good to be in the presence of God, but I just always want to remind you guys that there is Wednesday night Bible study.
Don't forget
at 7 p.m.
Yep.
My bad.
Don't forget to tune in to children's service.
And make sure you pay your tithe and offering. I mean, plant that seed so God could give you an overwhelming abundance of blessings. You just don't know how powerful that is, because me speaking personally, I know how good God is when I give.
Amen.
But you know what? I just want to take this time to let you guys know, you know, we always focus on the things that we don't have. I want a new car. I want a better job. I want better this. I want better that. But you know what? We got to take a step back and realize what we are thankful for, what God already has for us. Things small, like taking a walk. Things small, like our shoes, our clothes on our back, the cars that we have. We got to stop complaining about things that we want, but be thankful for the things that we have. Our family, you know, really matters. And right now, all of us together, we know that God is good, and God will always continue to be good, but we always just got to stay encouraged. But I just want to let you guys know that we love you, and God is good, and God is real.
He sure is. And remember, you're always too blessed to be stressed. Amen. Thank you so much for tuning in with us. Let's have a wonderful service.
Love ya.
No, just want to celebrate the goodness of God. God is so good to us. Amen. And so without further ado, you know, I want to encourage you. You know, we put a link out there for those who have prayer requests. Copy that link off of our Facebook page and share it with all your friends and neighbors so that we can begin to pray for the body more effectively. Amen. Go with me to 2 Kings, the 6th chapter, and the 1st verse. And the sons of the prophets said unto Elisha, Behold, now the place where we dwell with thee is too strait for us. Let us go, we pray thee, unto the Jordan, and take thence every man a beam, and let us make a place there where we may dwell. And he answered, Go ye. And one said, Be content, I pray thee, go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. So he went with them, and when they came to the Jordan, they cut down wood. But as one was failing a beam, the axe head fell into the water, and he cried and said, Alas, master, for it was borrowed. And the man of God said, Where fell it? Heavenly Father, Lord, bless the reading, the hearing of your word. Be glorified, God, right now in the name of Jesus, as we submit ourselves unto you. Amen and amen. Well, God is good. And as we live this time and this season in our lives, if you will, this is a unique season in life. Unlike what most of us have ever experienced. Amen. We had the pandemic. We, you know, on top of that, we have racial unrest, if you will, in our country, which that in itself is not new, but it's new in terms of the way our society is responding to it. Amen. And so today, if you will, I want to just talk to you. I just want you to just lean in, if you will, because God wants to help us navigate this, because so many of us, if you will, would like to go back to the beginning of 2020 and press restart. But guess what? We can't go back to the beginning of 2020 and press restart. Amen. And we have to understand this. We have to understand that God is in control, that God is not surprised, and yet God is trying to position us to move forward. If we go back even to the times of Jesus, if you will, you know, Jesus prepared us, if you will, for this. We just have to learn how to trust the Lord. But here we are in our scripture text. And in our scripture text, we find that the school of the prophets were gathered together, and as the school of the prophets, if you will, these men, they were understudies. They were preparing to walk, if you will, in the office of a prophet, and yet the reality is that, you know what, we should never ever get to the place that we think that we've outgrown, if you will, our leader. So these men, they came together and they began to look at their surroundings, and they began to think that the surrounding was too small. But sometimes people think more of themselves than they ought to think, and yet one man came and he said, "Master, we want to go and build a new place." And Elisha said, "You know, hey, go ahead. If that's what you feel like you need to do, go ahead." And another said, "Hey, no, come with us." And as they were out there, as they were chopping down the tree, one man's axe head fell into the water. And I need you to understand, because this is the reality, if you will, the axe handle represents the gifting of God. All of us have a gift. All of us have a gift of the things that God has given us, and whatever gift God gives us, he gives it to us so that we can use it for his glory, not for our glory, amen. But we get blessed, if you will. We can be blessed in the overflow, but if you can get to the place that you recognize that whatever gift you have, God has given it to you, if you will, to use for his glory. And yet, as one man was chopping down this tree, the axe head fell into the water. Now, that axe head, if you will, is the cutting edge. And the reality is that as a ministry, as an individual, we need to learn how to stay on the cutting edge. We need to learn how to stay, if you will, sharp right there, right? So when the axe head fell into the water, the man said, "Where fell it?" Right? And the man of God said, you know, he said, "Where fell it?" And he looked and he caused the axe head to swim. So the revelation is this, is that the handle is the gift, if you will. And if you will, the axe head is the character or the charisma of God. So we need to understand that the axe head represents the anointing of God. And in times like this, we need to move and believe that it's not just the gift that God gives us that causes us to move, but it is God's anointing. And we need God's yoke-breaking anointing, because it's the anointing that breaks the yoke. It's the anointing that brings us to the place that God wants us to operate in. Amen. God is calling us and wanting us to grow up in him. Amen. And as we begin to grow up in him, as we begin to see the hand of God move on our life, we begin to understand that sometimes in life we get sidetracked. Sometimes we get so focused in on our own stuff, or sometimes we allow sin to creep in. And when sin creeps in, that's where the axe head falls. But sadly, too many people don't remember where the axe head fell. And let me tell you something, because the Holy Spirit is oftentimes telling you, don't do that, don't do this, go this way, go that way. But sometimes we are so focused in on what we want, how we want, when we want, that we turn the Holy Spirit off, right? And the Lord is trying to help us not turn the Holy Spirit off, right? Because the Holy Spirit is there to lead us, to guide us into all truths. Amen. And I need you to understand today that God wants us to get to that place. Amen. That we break out. We've been in a season, if you will, and God wants us to break out. Break out of the old way, break out of the old mindset, if you will, right? Break out of trying to do it my way. It's not McDonald's, amen. You know, it's not Burger King special orders. Don't upset us. You know, hey, no, God's got a way. God's got a plan. And it's not our way and it's not our plan, but it's the plan of the Lord. Amen. And so when the axe head falls into the water, if you can recognize that the axe has fallen, if you can recognize, because this is the deal. Have you ever seen someone who's gifted and anointed of God? Have you ever seen them minister? Have you ever seen them sing? Have you ever seen them yield themselves to the Lord? And oftentimes it is just a note. And it's just like this. There was an old farmer one time, who had gotten to the place that he had to sell everything that he had, right? And his farm got put up for auction. Everything got put up for auction. And people started bidding, if you will, for this and for that. And yet, all of a sudden, the man, the auctioneer picked up this little violin and he said, this, we're going to start the bidding right here. And they began to bid and it was very low bid. And all of a sudden, the old man took the violin in his hands and he began to play. And as he began to play, there was such an anointing that began to arise and that the people began to bid and the bid shot through the ceiling. And I need you to understand, because what happened was, is that once that instrument got into the hand of the master, it wasn't a worn, beat up violin anymore, but it was a masterpiece. And that's what God wants for our life. He wants us to be a masterpiece. But yet if we just operate in our gift, we get beat up by life. We get beat up by the things in this life, huh? And sometimes what happens is that because we're holding on to our position, we're holding on to the things that we want, the things that we think, right? We get ragdolled around. We get beat up. We get slapped around, if you will, rather than just letting go and letting God. And so today I'm trying to encourage you just to let go and to let God. I'm trying to encourage you to be able to point back. And I want you to go through the recesses of your mind. I want you to look at your life. I want you to look at the things and the moments when the Holy Spirit said, don't do it, and you decided to push on the accelerator anyway. The moment when the Holy Spirit said, shut up or be quiet. That you would listen to the voice of God and allow God to begin to speak to your heart. Allow God to speak to your heart. Amen. Sometimes there are things that we just decide to do. But God wants us to get to that place that we can operate in his anointing. And when we begin to operate in God's anointing, you see, it's just like chopping down a tree. You can chop down a tree with a sharp axe or a dull axe. And a dull axe, you might get there, but most of the time you won't. Most of the time you wear out before you can get there. But a sharp axe begins to penetrate. And that's what the anointing does. The anointing begins to penetrate, if you will, life's issues, penetrate the things that we're dealing with, if you will. See, we need to understand, because God, if you will, has a plan for our life. And as we begin to understand that there's a plan for our life, we understand, if you will, that in John 14, verse 16, and it says, I pray the Father that he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be with you. Amen. Talking about the Holy Spirit, right? Christ said, he said, I'm praying. He said, I've got clout with the Father. He said, look, I am about to go, but I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit comes, if you will, he is the comforter, the paracletus. If you will, he is here to help us, if you will, navigate this life. But sometimes we choose not to listen to the Holy Spirit because we're listening to other voices, right? And so we can't even not listen to the other voices, and we can't just trust our own thought. But we've got to even let the Lord begin to direct our thoughts. We need to let the Lord begin to speak to our hearts and to our minds, if you will, because he knows what we don't know. He sees what we don't see. Amen. God wants us to grow up in him. God wants us to mature in him. But this is the season, church, because we're living in a time, if you will, that the Bible talked about. And as we begin to say that it is the end time, it's not the beginning of the end, though some might want to think that it's the beginning of the end. But this is the end of the end. And more than ever before, we need to be a people who are walking in the anointing of God. Amen? Because guess what? When we can walk in the anointing of God, then God can cause us to see through muddy water and spy dry ground. God can cause us to begin to see the things that are hard to see and begin to deal with some people that are hard to deal with. Emotionally, when we look at the things that are happening in our country right now, they're very challenging to us, right? They're very challenging, but guess what? It's going to get worse. I'd like to tell you that everything's going to be peaches and cream, but in society, things are going to become more intensified, if you will, right? We as the church and the body, we cannot afford to be people that just operate in our own giftings, but we have to operate in the anointing of the Lord. And in order to operate in the anointing of the Lord, we have to yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit. Amen. And as we begin to yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit, we allow the Holy Spirit to endue us. We allow the Holy Spirit to fill us up. We allow the Holy Spirit to take us, if you will. Amen. And as he begins to take us and guide us and lead us, if you will, God begins to say, you're now this instrument that I can play. You're this instrument that I can use. You're this instrument that I can place in a place and trust you. See, can God trust you? Can God trust you? See, I can't answer that for you, but I have to answer that for me. Can God trust me to shut my mouth when I need to shut my mouth? Can God trust me to say when I need to say something? Can God trust me to just do the right thing when I need to do it? Because God is looking for a man and woman of God that won't get ahead of what the Spirit is doing, that won't get ahead of what he's doing in the church, that won't get ahead of leadership, that'll be submitted to God and connected to leadership. Because this is the very hour that we all need a shepherd, amen? And we, like sheep, will go astray, if you will, or have gone astray. We need to understand that Jesus, if you will, is our shepherd, amen? That Jesus is the one that is wanting to lead, guide, and direct us, if you will. He's trying to bring us to a place in him. Because where the anointing is, that's where the Spirit of the Lord is. It's the Spirit of the Lord. And where that is, there is liberty. But too many of us have not been able to operate in that liberty because we've been bound by the thoughts in our mind. We've been bound by the things of the past. We've been bound because of what other people did or did not do. But let me tell you something. It's time for us to simply trust the Lord. We're going to see that this is an unprecedented time. And for those who will yield themselves to the Lord, for those who are willing to say, God, this is where the anointing fell. This is where the axe head fell. For those who are willing to say that, God is going to cause the impossible to happen. He's going to cause the axe head to swim, yet metal doesn't swim. But when the anointing of God comes in the situation, when the anointing of God steps in, what shouldn't happen will happen. So I need you to think about in your life the areas that you have allowed the axe head to fall, the areas that you operate in your gift rather than in the anointing of God. Stop trying to outsmart God. You know, I was talking to somebody the other day, or two people were talking, and I listened and I thought, and I just offered the comment. I said, who's he trying to convince? You know, I said, sound like he's trying to convince somebody. And the guy looked over at me. He says, I'm trying to convince myself. See, sometimes we just talk and we say stuff. And we're hoping that we're convincing the people we're talking to. But the reality is we don't even believe what we're saying. So let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. Stop trying to put belief in your own strength. Yes, God has given you some abilities. And when you can use those abilities for his kingdom, God will anoint them, and that anointing will be a yoke buster. Amen. Like a bunker buster bomb. Like a bunker buster bomb. What's a bunker buster bomb? You see, oftentimes in wartime, there will be people who will get into a bunker to protect themselves, and that bunker is reinforced, right? Well, let me tell you something. God wants to use this anointing to break through those bunkers, if you will. Bust through those bunkers. There's some bunkers that you've been in, and we need the anointing to bust in so that we can bust out. We need them to bust in so that we can bust out for the kingdom. We need God to bust in some areas in our life so that we can bust out for the kingdom. Amen. So that God can be glorified in our life. Amen. I'm telling you, it's time to play lights out. It's time to put everything on the table and just say, God, whatever you want to do, however you want to do it, use me. However you want to do this thing, whatever you want to do, God, have your way. Because God is sending the Holy Spirit to minister to us. He's sending the Holy Spirit to pour into us. Amen. God wants us to begin to yield ourselves. And guess what? We don't want him just to pour a little bit in. But we want him to pour it to overflowing. We want God to shift the dynamic. Amen. We want God to be able to flow through us so that lives can be changed. Because as these lives are changed, guess what? They're changed because God said, you're this instrument in my hand, and I'm going to move. I'm going to move people, if you will, by the power of the anointing in your life, if you will. And the anointing that's in your life, you only have because I've given it to you for that moment. See, God gives you an anointing that remains, but the bunker-busting anointing is that is borrowed. It is a borrowed anointing. It belongs to the Father. And the Father says, I've given you gifts for kingdom's sake, and I want to use these giftings, if you will, for the kingdom. But rather than some people want to use it for their own gain, we can't use it for our own gain. We got to use it for the kingdom. But the first thing that we just simply must do is come to the place that I say, God, the first place that needs to be right, I got to get right. See, that servant, when he turned to Elisha and said, the axe head master has fallen in the water. And he said, alas, it's borrowed. We need to turn to God and say, the axe head has fallen in the water. You know, I remember, I thought about this, you know, some time ago, and I remember thinking years and years ago when an incident happened, and I just began to repent of something that was years and years ago, and God caused me to repent of that thing, closing that door. Amen. See, there are things, there are doors, there are things that you have allowed access in you to your life because you did not close a door. And then don't say that you're too far down the line. No, begin to repent of the thing. Begin to turn away from that thing. Begin to not just turn away from that thing, but turn back to God. Because as you turn back to God, God will be glorified in your life. I'm telling you, I'm desperate for the King. I have no other choice but to yield my life to the King. And I'm telling you, because God is doing some things supernaturally. God is shifting some things supernaturally. And so we need to understand that as there's that anointing that is borrowed, that as we give it back to God, as we begin to give ourselves a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, in other words, I'm going to take myself and I'm going to put it on the altar. And then I'm going to look to the Lord. And I'm going to say, Lord, I'm starting where I am with what I have. And I'm putting myself on the altar. Lord, my mother, my brother, my sister, everybody else, they need you too. But God, I need to put myself first on the altar so that I can be used to help them. So that I can be used to speak to them. So that I can be used to minister to the stranger, if you will. So that I can be used, God, as a Bible. God, so that I can be used where I don't hide in shame, God, what you brought me out of. But God, I can lift up as a banner to say, God, you've delivered me. And most of the time, God, what I needed to be delivered most from was from me. The inner me's within me. Huh? God, you protected me from the enemy. But now, God, you need to help me be delivered from the inner me. Because sometimes we give others grace and we help others, but we stay in the place that God doesn't want us to stay. Spiritually speaking, God wants us to break out and to get over or to get away from a thing. Amen. And sometimes, if you will, you won't allow somebody else to stay there, but you allow yourself to stay there. And God is saying, it's time for you to break out. It's time for you to bring whatever that thing is. And in order to do that, you got to know who the Holy Spirit is, because God uses the God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They use the Holy Spirit to anoint us. Amen. And the Holy Spirit, he's the comforter. Amen. So we got to know who he is. And we need to know that the comforter, if you will, doesn't come and talk about himself, but he talks about, if you will, Jesus, if you will. And then we got to know, what does he do, if you will? Amen. What does he do? What does he do, right? He's there to help us. He's there to speak to us. He's there to give us instruction. Amen. And then the Holy Spirit not only is there to give us instruction, but then guess what? He wants us to be able to apply it to our life. See, because there are many of us that know the word. There are many of us that know what's right to do, but you're still doing wrong. Yeah, I know you'd rather for me to just tickle your ears, but I'm here to tell you there's some things in your life that need to be changed. And sometimes it's just that you just need to submit. You need to yield yourself to the Holy Spirit. In this world today, people don't want to submit, and submission is a bad word. But let me tell you something. We need to simply submit to the Holy Spirit. We need to be able to submit, if you will, to the authority that God has given us. Amen. We need to be able to stand, if you will. Just because everybody else is doing something doesn't mean that we need to do it. Can you stand and magnify the King? Can you stand and glorify the Lord? Can you stand and just trust the Lord? And then when you get to that place, God wants you to get to the place that you can do what? That you could begin to do the practical application. Look at your phone. You've got apps. Look on your computer. You've got apps. But God wants to know, you know, he wants you to be able to push that icon. And what does that icon look like? It looks like Jesus. He wants you to push that icon in you, in your spirit, that says, Jesus or Holy Spirit, operate within me. Because when you click on an icon on your phone, amen, when you click on that app, when you click on that icon on your phone, it opens up an app. That application. The icon is the picture. It's the image of whatever they want to show you. So you click on the icon, and then it opens up an application. And so the Lord is saying, I want you to click on the icon. I'm going to let the icon show you what it should look like. And the icon is the image. And the image that we should click on is Jesus. Amen. We should want our life to look like or to mirror Jesus. And so when we click on the icon, the application, because when you click on the icon, all of a sudden what was on the inside begins to come out. So when we click on the icon, the application of Jesus, the application of holiness, the application of living right before God should open up and begin to flow through us. Amen. It should open up and begin to flow through us. Should open up and begin to take control. Amen. See, we need to understand that he is there to lead us. And in this time and in this season, we need to know that he is here to lead us. Amen. Our bishop used to say a lot of times, I don't know where I'm going, but I do know who I'm following. We may not know all of the next steps, but we do need to know this, who we're following, and we're following the Lord. And if we follow the Lord, we know we win in the end. Amen? We know that we win. We know that the Lord is glorified in our life. Amen? We know that the Lord is there to have his way. Amen? Because when we do that, Matthew 28:19-20, it says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you even to the end of the world. He said, look, teach them to recognize the icon. Teach them to be able to click on the application. See, and the application is when God can say, I can trust you, not just to talk about it, but to be about it. The application is when you say, when God says, look, I can put you in a tough situation, and I know that you're going to represent the kingdom, not suddenly divert and become a representative of your own self. See, this earth is not our home. Our home is in heaven. This is not our kingdom, but yet we're kingdom representatives. Amen. And when the Holy Spirit comes, when the Holy Spirit begins to move, in John 14:27, he begins to talk about that he gives us peace. See, some of us, we're not yielding ourselves to the Holy Spirit, so we don't have the peace. God wants us to have peace that surpasses all understanding. God wants us to have peace even in the midst of the storm. God wants us to have peace that causes people to be baffled. How can they have peace? How can they continue to function the way they function, if you will? How can they sleep at night? Amen. There've been moments in my life when I didn't leave it in the hand of God, and I couldn't sleep at night. But once I learned how to put it in God's hand and leave it. And what does that look like? It looks like that I put it in God's hand, and then I began to listen for God's instruction. And when I listened to God's instruction, I just did what he said for me to do. And when I did what he said for me to do, I just trusted him. I don't know how it's going to work out or what's going to do, but I'm just going to trust the Lord, because I know this, that it's better when I trust the Lord than when I just trust myself. John 15:9-10, he talks to us about the love of God. We need the love of God. We need to operate in that agape love. That means that you don't just choose that I'm going to love this person and I'm not going to love that person. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And it's only through the power of the Holy Spirit that we can love. And we have to love even our enemies. We have to love even those who mean us harm, amen? Because it's the love of God that will transform their life. It's the love of God that ministers to our soul. It's the love of God. And we need God to take control of our lives. And we need to, first of all, know that God loves you so much that even in the midst of all the stuff, you know, the stuff that nobody else knows about in your life. Come on, raise your hand if there's something in your life that nobody else knows about, right? There's some things in your life, and yet God says, even with that in your life, he still loves you. Even with that in your life, he's still moving on your behalf. Even with that in your life, God says, I got a purpose and plan for you. We have to have that kind of love, that yoke-breaking love, that love that causes someone who ordinarily would run away, if you will, to cause them to begin to yield, to cause them to begin to submit themselves to the king, to cause them the atmosphere to begin to change. And then in John 15:10-11, God says, I'm going to give you joy that surpasses all understanding. He says, I'm going to give you joy. This joy. And guess what? The world didn't give it to you. So stop letting the world take your joy. The world didn't give it to you. So don't let the world take your joy. The joy is an inside job. I'm not talking about happiness, because happiness deals with happenstance. But joy means that no matter what's going on, it may be raging a storm outside, no matter what's happening, I'm going to have the joy of the Lord. And so what do? I come to God and I say, God, the axe head fell. God, my anointing, the anointing that you lent to me, God, I let it fall. Or maybe it's not as sharp as it needs to be. God, I need to get back to the place that I'm on the cutting edge. I need to get back to that place that I'm on the sharp edge. I need to get back to that place that, God, all you have to do is whisper and I'm running with full conviction. My son plays the drums, and his drum teacher was telling him the other day, and he said, look, you know the song, and he played it just like it. He said, but when you shift to this part, don't play it timidly, but just play it with all the confidence, because you know it. And that's what we need to do. When we hear God speak, don't walk timidly, but walk with the confidence of God. Come boldly to the throne of grace and walk into what God has said. Instead of hitting all the right notes at the right time, but without the confidence, God is saying, believe his word. God is saying, believe the prophets. God is saying, believe, if you will, the Holy Spirit that is there to lead, guide, and direct you into all truth. Amen. God is saying, look, not only are you going to recover your axe head, if you will, but I'm going to cause you to be used to help cut through, if you will, the things that have bound others. And I'm going to use you as an example to break through so that others can be free as well, so that the Lord would be glorified in your life. God wants you to get to that place. Amen. The Holy Spirit wants us just to do what? Yield. Yield to him and to magnify the Lord. And so I say to you today, if you will, get back to the place. Because the reality is that these sons of the prophet, you know what they wanted to do? They wanted to get to the Jordan. They wanted to go build a place at the Jordan. But guess what? We can't leapfrog. Because what they were really wanting to do is get to the place that they could operate in sonship. And they wanted to operate in sonship without going through the process. And so to go to the process, they got to start off at a place called Gilgal. And when they start off at a place called Gilgal, they let God begin to cut on them. Because Gilgal is a place of cutting. Gilgal is a place of a circle, a place of cutting, a place of letting God deal with you. And then from Gilgal, you need to let God take you to the place of Bethel. And there at Bethel, Bethel is the house of God. Bethel is the place where the church, if you will, is activated and submitted to God, is being used of God, is learning of God. And then guess what? All of us have the Jerichos in our life. But sometimes we falter at Jericho because we didn't do what we needed to do at Bethel. Sometimes we falter at Jericho because we didn't do what we needed to do at Gilgal. We didn't make the real commitment. We didn't come clean. And we were too busy trying to look good rather than come clean with God. If you come clean with God, not only will you look good, but you will be good. And if you don't look as good as you want, sometimes you look better than you think because you just came clean with God. And God says, I can use that one. And sometimes those moments when you thought, man, I got an egg on my face, and God says, you humbled yourself, I'm going to exhort you. But sometimes you're too busy trying to exhort yourself. God says, I got to humble you. Right? It's not about us, but it's all about him. And if it's all about him, we need to yield to God and let God be glorified in his life. Let God have his way. And then at God's appointed time, there's the Jordan. But let me tell you something, it's a cycle. It's a thing that we go through. And sometimes it's seasons, but every day you've got to come back to that place, Gilgal. Every day you got to go to the place, Bethel. Every day you got to deal with some kind of Jericho. The enemy's always fighting, always trying to hinder you. And every day God wants to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. God wants to give you a reward. And even if the reward is, God says, you got another opportunity today to represent the king. Praise the Lord. Begin to magnify the King. And I trust that you have heard this word and that you're going to allow the Holy Spirit to take control of your life, not just to wake you up, but then to give you the anointing to do what you need to do on a daily basis to represent the King. And that's by presenting your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. In other words, don't hold anything back and let the Holy Spirit point out to you the things that he needs to work on. In Jesus' name, be blessed. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, I just pray for your favor. I pray, God, that you would minister to the people. I pray, God, that you would be glorified in all that is said and done right now in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And now I encourage you, I pray that you would give your tithes and offerings, that you would love on the Lord. And not only that, once again, that's an application. Trusting the Lord that he's going to provide for you, trusting the Lord that you're going to give thanks for what he's already given you and give back to him. Amen. So give your tithes and offerings And those of you who have children, please join us from Children's Church. It's an awesome and incredible message. Be blessed. See you soon.
All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. Yeah. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. Yeah. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God.
Oh Lord, we bless your name and we give you